It's the fall of 1985. Time to strike up the band to set the beat. Raise the flag to signal the impending battles. And we'll dress you up in appropriate style to prepare to meet the 1985 Oroville High School varsity football team. Tiger fans celebrate what will be a perfect regular season, perfect for a group of players who worked as one in pursuit of greatness. It would all start with the game against Wheatland at Harrison Stadium, and as would be appropriate for a team dominating in defense, a safety. A block punt through the end zone and Oroville goes up 2-0. And the bounces even went Oroville's way as Melvin Broadway picks up the ball, fires to tight end Scott Burnham. It's good to the 32-yard line. Then Broadway once again will find Burnham to the opposite side of the field. This pass will set up a Carl Ray Hills touchdown run. Oroville would lead 9-0. And then it would be Hills on his own. He'll take the ball 88 yards for the touchdown. To open the second half, the Tigers were already up 15-0. Oroville's defense again digs in. This time it's Andy Mata who's going to make the hit for a loss against the Pirates. Then it's going to be a big pass rush. RJ Sharp on the other end will break up the pass. The pass rush again, forcing Wheatland to throw much faster than it really wants to. And then the whole thing is capped by an intercepted pass. It will set up Oroville High School with one more offensive series as the Tigers will punch it into the end zone with a Melvin Broadway bootleg run. He'll take it the entire 47 yards. The Tigers record the shutout in the opening game of the 1985 season. Rack up a 22-0 victory for the Tigers as they beat the Wheatland Pirates. Oroville would begin its first of three shutouts in its pursuit of greatness for 1985. On to Marysville, a rare Thursday night appearance. Oroville's offense finding it very tough to get into the end zone, though it was able to drive the ball up and down the field. This interception exemplifying the frustration that the Tigers felt against a cat-quick Lyndhurst Blazer team. But then again, Lyndhurst must have felt all too frustrated by Oroville's defense. Here the Tigers send seams everyone, as they will get to the quarterback for the first of many sacks. Want proof of many? This time, Broadway is intercepted once again by the Blazers as the Tigers are able to push it close once again. Penalties also hurt Oroville early as the game remains scoreless. That is until Lyndhurst got the ball and Oroville punched them backwards into the end zone. This safety gave the Tigers the lead early on. The second safety in as many games for the Tigers to open up the scoring. Right after that, the Tigers put it into the end zone. Broadway with this run on the sprint option. It would set up the touchdown, and the Tigers would go on to the 8-0 victory, perhaps their hardest fought win of the non-league play. Back home to take on the Shasta Wolves in a longtime rivalry, and Oroville would get the right bounce. They'd recover the ball at the Shasta 31-yard line. Not too long after that, Jeff Danner would go for 40 yards. Danner, replacing the injured Carl Ray Hills, would have the first of two fine ball games as the Tigers went up 7-0. He would become an All-Eastern Athletic League tackle going both ways. Steve Ross tackling the Wolves for a loss. And then there's Butch Townsend. He's also an All-Leaguer, and he throws the Wolves backwards. Let's make it two. Back on offense, the Tigers' Melvin Broadway will hit R.J. Sharp for the touchdown. 14-0, Oroville on top. Townsend comes through defensively once again, blocking this punt by Shasta. That sets up the touchdown as Jack Berry will be putting it into the end zone. Berry's run gave the Tigers the 21-0 lead. Three shutouts in a row for Oroville. Could the Tigers make it four? They'd never opened a season with four straight shutouts. They've done it before with three, but they couldn't quite turn out the lights on Red Bluff, at least scoring-wise. The Tigers coach Jim McNulty had hoped the first time his defense would give up a score that it wouldn't feel let down to the point that it would give up a victory. Red Bluff did punch into the end zone on the first drive of the game, but then Oroville turned right back around and started to run it down the Spartans' throat, literally, in the name of Jeff Danner. also proved that he had the good hands, too. A dangerous pitch. He'll take it down deep into Spartan territory to set up the touchdown. And what better number to call than the number one? Jeff Danner would put it into the end zone. He would rush for over 100 yards for the first time in his career against the Spartans. It wasn't just Danner, though. Constantly giving the ball to Jeff set up Billy Goals for a score on a simple blast play. Tigers up 14-7. And when it wasn't the run, the Tigers used the pass. Andy Mata, all-leaguer going both ways once the EAL season began, set himself up for all-EA honors with this touchdown reception from Broadway. And on the last play of the ballgame, Broadway called his own number as Oroville High made it 28-7, the victory over Red Bluff. Oroville now 4-0. The Tigers would host Central Valley the following week, and Danner would keep going on his assault for a potential 1,000-yard season. His cutback against the grain for the score against the soon-to-be winless Falcons made it 7-0. And then the Oroville defense decided giving up points the previous week wasn't exactly something it liked all that much. And so for loss after loss, the Falcons would be dropped. In fact, Central Valley was held to minus 14 yards rushing for the game. Back on offense, Broadway found Isidro Alvarez, another one of his fine complement of receivers, and a defensive backfield mate. It set up a Danner touchdown to make it 14-0. And then Broadway with this run, well, 37 yards, the running says it all. Just so you don't have to rewind the tape, here's a second look at the same play. Then Broadway made it look a little bit easier when he put it in from 14 yards out. Final score, Oroville 27, Central Valley nothing. The Tigers undefeated in non-league play for the first time since 1978. Next up, the Eastern Athletic League and the Victory Bell game. The Tigers and the T-Birds. And Danner was the man that the T-Birds were supposed to stop. It didn't work on this play. Danner rushes to the 35-yard line. Later in the first half, Broadway would find Billy Goals on a touchdown pass. 7-0. The Tigers took the lead against the crosstown rivals. Next time the Tigers got the ball, it was Danner again. This time, though, he would take it the distance. Tigers went up 14-0, and after giving up a touchdown to Las Plumas, led 14-7 as the second half would get underway. Carl Hills, back after his shoulder injury, takes this late pitch from Broadway, and he'll rush it to the 27-yard line. It set up a field goal attempt that went awry for the Tigers, so it was still a 7-point lead. Later, though, Broadway hits Mata with a pass play to the 40-yard line. It set up a field goal that was good for the Tigers. 17-7, they took the lead up to 10 points. Goals, after scoring on offense, sets up another touchdown on defense. He intercepts Cameron Buck and returns at 26 yards to the 1-yard line. Jack Berry would punch it in, and that made the score 24-7. Oroville got everybody into the game, and Buck was intercepted by John Murphy. As it was an entire team show for the Oroville Tigers, Berry would put it in for the final touchdown. The Tigers retain the victory bell with a win of 30-7 over the Las Plumas T-Birds. And the Tigers were one up in the Eastern Athletic League. Chico is always tough, and supposedly in a down year, the Panthers didn't show it against the Tigers at Harrison Stadium. The Panther defense held Oroville in check and kept Melvin Broadway from getting anywhere. Though Oroville scored first on a field goal, the Panthers got just the right bounce. School record-setting quarterback Rock Santos would get behind the secondary with the throw, and the Panthers would lead 7-3. The Panthers were still getting to Broadway, who was sacked 10 times during the game. But then the Panthers were forced to punt, and Oroville finally found its way back into the contest. Andy Mata would take the ball at the 48-yard line, return it 16 yards to the 32. On second and nine, Jeff Danner would carry it outside to the 20-yard line. A penalty and a sack would then come, as would the fourth quarter. Then Broadway found R.J. Sharp deep in Panther territory. He sneaks into the end zone. That was good enough for the win, as the Tigers would hold on for a 10-7 victory over the Panthers. And as if that wasn't enough, the next week would be the vaunted Pleasant Valley Vikings in a showdown for the EAL title. University Stadium in Chico, Pleasant Valley boasted running back Jeff Trimmer, and this is why. But Oroville would hold down deep. Pleasant Valley settles for a field goal. But Oroville couldn't get moving, as Broadway was intercepted early. And the Tigers had to wonder if they were ever going to get into the game with the Vikings. The defense had no problems. Tovey Giesentanner is going to find that Butch Townsend knew him well on this sack. Then Oroville gets on the scoreboard with the touchdown. The pitch to Danner. He puts it into the end zone after a couple of nifty moves. Tigers lead 7-3. Then the Tigers would get another blocked punt in against the opposition. It would set up an Oroville field goal attempt, but the Tigers would miss three of those on the night. Pleasant Valley comes right back, a pass down deep to the 17-yard line. It would set up the touchdown pass by Giesentanner, and the Vikings led 9-7. It was Danner's turn once again for Oroville. He takes the ball straight ahead to the 38. Then that Broadway Mata connection. Mata in motion to the right. He'll be open on the right side. And the score. 14-9, Tigers lead it. In what started to look like a track meet, the Oroville defense got a tip pass into the hands of Mata. And that set up yet another field goal attempt by Oroville that would again miss. That would end the first half, the Tigers up by five. There was no scoring in the third quarter. In the fourth, Pleasant Valley got things moving once again. This Giesentanner pass goes to the 21, but the Vikings would find themselves with fourth and short. You figured they would send it to Trimmer, their running back. But no, they go ahead and throw on a gamble, going for the touchdown, figuring Oroville was playing soft, but the overthrow kept Pleasant Valley from getting back in the game. Turn it back around, Goals puts it into the end zone, gives the Tigers the 21-9 victory over the Vikings. The toughest competition behind them, the Tigers were now 8-0. Two teams that were supposedly going to be gimmies would provide the Tigers their final opposition of the regular season. But next up was Lassen. Goals would punt into the end zone for a touchback. Normally routine, but on the very next play, it would prove to be vital in terms of field position. Don McIntyre, sophomore quarterback for Lassen, throws right into the hands of Goals, who returns it for a touchdown, and that made it 7-0 in favor of Oroville. It was the same play that cost Las Plumas in similar fashion only 2 weeks before. Butch Townsend gets the sack against McIntyre. And then Oroville scores on this Danner run. But wait, 162 yards and penalties in the game, including on that play. The touchdown was called back. So on the next play, Oroville does it for real. Broadway to Mata for the score. That made it 14-0. But Lassen would hang tough. They would score a touchdown to make it 14-7. In the second half, it's going to be Broadway to Burnham, a combination that hadn't been seen much in recent weeks. Burnham scores on the 46-yard pass play. It's 21-7. Lassen would score again on a McIntyre pass. They would miss the conversion. Oroville would hold on to win 21-13, clinching at least a tie for the Eastern Athletic League title and the home field advantage for the 4A playoffs, which would be just 2 weeks hence. Paradise stood between Oroville and a perfect regular season. The Tigers would go from the wishbone for their first score against the Bobcats on the ridge. Carl Ray Hills would put it in. It was 7-0. The Tigers would get the ball right back. They decided to go for it on fourth and short in Paradise territory. But Broadway's attempt to pitch to Jack Berry ended up looking like a banana escaping from its peel. Paradise would get the ball back, and this play would set up the Bobcats' touchdown. With Paradise within 1 point and Coach Don Barnes figuring he had nothing to lose, Paradise went for two and made it. So the Bobcats led 8-7, and that was the halftime score. Into the fourth quarter, Oroville stopped Paradise deep in its own territory. So the Bobcats were forced to punt, and not a terribly good effort. Mata will gobble this one up, return it 19 yards to the 20. That would set up the Tigers' second touchdown of the night, as Hills would put it in for his second score of the evening. The extra point failed, but that was good enough still to give Oroville a 13-8 lead. And then the defense dug in. Paradise held to less than 15 yards total offense in the second half of play. Sack after sack after sack. And the Tigers could feel that their pursuit of greatness would then be a meeting with greatness. It was only a matter of minutes away. The last play of the game, an incomplete pass. The Tigers were 10-0, their first perfect regular season since 1978. And the Eastern Athletic League Championship was theirs outright. A perfect season would lead to the playoffs, a matchup with the Enterprise Hornets. And the Tigers were seeking their first playoff victory since 1927. Harrison Stadium the site. Enterprise tried to get on the board first with a 54-yard field goal that would have tied a North Section record for a length, but it was blocked. And the block sets up the Tigers' lead of 6-0. Then on the ensuing kickoff, the Hornets couldn't hold on. The Tigers would recover. Though the Tigers failed to score on that drive, to begin the second quarter, they managed to put 6 on the board as Carl Ray Hills would score his third touchdown in 2 weeks. And the Tigers were ahead 13-0. It looked as if the rout was on. Further evidence, a halfback option pass that would be picked off by Isidro Alvarez. But the Tigers couldn't score on that drive. Enterprise would get the ball right back. Kyle Gilbreth would throw a touchdown pass, and it was 13-7, the Tigers' lead cut to 6. But Butch Townsend had a stunning second quarter series with one sack of Gilbreth. And then another. And then the Tigers' number 56 would block that kick. Still, though, the Tigers only led by that scant 6-point margin until Goles returned an interception 14 yards for a score. It was his second touchdown interception return of the season. Tigers led by 13. Late in the game, Gilbreth would be stripped of the ball by Steve Ross. And though Gilbreth would win the battle for the ball, he was in the end zone. The safety gave Oroville a 22-7 victory. And the Tigers' pursuit of greatness took them to the North Section Championship Final against the Anderson Cubs. 11-0, a school record for a number of wins in a single season for the Oroville High School varsity football team of 1985.
Champions with an 11-0 record, head coach Bob Reed, assistants Jim Carter, Kirk Rick Russell, and Kyle Stemler. The Anderson offensive team, at center, number 65, Brad Wolf. Right guard, number 64, Butch Newsom. Left guard, number 74, Charlie Carmen. Right tackle, number 70, Jeff Crawford. Left tackle, number 57, Pete Brown. The tight end, number 38, Dan Chase. The wide receiver, number 42, Scott Lee. The flanker, number 11, Scott Edwards. The fullback, number 24, Dorian Kitchen. The tailback, number 34, Brian Byron Lytle. The quarterback, number 12, Tony Zanatelli. And the Anderson High School Cubs. And now, the host, EAR champion, with an 11-0 record, Oroville High School Tigers, Coach Powell, Jim McLaughlin, Tom Aldridge, Ron Harrison, and Ben Kirkland. The defensive team, the nose guard, number 38, Lance Thomas. The left defensive tackle, number 72, Steve Ross. The right defensive tackle, number 79, Al Hammond. The left defensive end, number 66, Cale Dodd. The right defensive end, number 56, Butch Townsend. The middle linebacker, number 44, Bill Gore. The left linebacker, number 34, Al Hart. The right linebacker, number 1, Jeff Brunner. The right cornerback, number 19, Andy Mata. The left cornerback, number 3, Isidro Alvarez. The safety, number 2, Melvin Broadway. The Oroville High School Tigers. Championship is about underway. Information. Line of six. Rose will start. Information for the Cubs. Kitchen and confirmation. Thank you. information. The touchdown. Jason Lovick to attempt the extra point out of Tony Phillips' hold. Lovick's kick is good. With a minute and 12 seconds left in the first half, Oroville 7 and 0. Jason Lovick added the extra point. 7 and 0. Very set to kick for the Tigers. Lee and Edwards. Two for the taken by Jeff Dean. Cubs. beat the Tigers.
Yeah.
to attempt the extra point. Charles Jacobs. 7 minutes to go in the game. 35-17, Corning over the winners. Here it goes, deep for the pass. It was a magnificent deep. Presentations for the 4A North Section Championship Trophy and the runner-up presented by the North Section Commissioner Greg LeMaster. The Oroville High Tigers going 12-0 to 1985 4A North Section Trophy. Also, we find you listening to KORG post-game interviews with Ron Flatter from the Oroville High School locker room. Also, reminder, Channel 9, tomorrow, 10 o'clock, the entire game televised play-by-play at 10 a.m. on Channel 9. Two very fine teams playing on the field tonight. blocks. Top-notch, very fine high school football game by two very fine, well-coached teams. Tomorrow morning,